in his own lifetime, when he brought the Ark of the Covenant to the holy city of Jerusalem, which is the habitation of the God of Jacob. Later, Solomon would complete his father's vow by building the temple, a permanent place where the glory of God might dwell. But the glory of God is too great to dwell in temples made of stone. We see this in the Old Testament because the appearance of the glory of God was always a terrible and frightening experience, burning with fire and smiting with thunder all who would approach it. Even the great saints of the Old Testament, the prophet Moses, the prophets Elijah, Jeremiah, and all the others, were barely able to receive that glory. In every case, they had to either turn away from the brightness of the Lord's glory or fall down before him in humility. Even in the New Testament, when the apostles Peter, James, and John beheld the Lord transfigured in glory upon Mount Tabor, even these great apostles, if we remember well, fell down before the revelation of the glory of Christ. This is so because man was not able, before the incarnation, before the resurrection and ascension of Christ, to fully approach the glory of God. Because of his disobedience, man had been cast out of the Garden of Paradise, that is, cast out of that spiritual place where he was able to commune freely with the Lord. Through his transgression and through his disobedience, however, man was placed outside of paradise, although the Lord in his mercy continued to present him for many years and for centuries the opportunity to return to that glory. The Ark of the Covenant, the Temple in Jerusalem, even the mighty Mount Sinai, none of these was able to bear the descent of the glory of God in the Old Testament. It would fall to a person to do this, to the humble maiden Mary, the all-pure Mother of God, whose nativity we celebrate today. The birth of the Mother of God was the ultimate fulfillment of the vow which the prophet David made to find a habitation, to find a dwelling place for the Lord of glory. The Blessed Virgin bore in her womb the fire of divinity, that same fire which Moses was not able to gaze upon in the burning bush. The Blessed Virgin is the ark, the resting place for God's glory, of which the prophet David speaks again when he says, "Arise, O Lord, thou in the ark of thy holiness." She is also the Zion that God has chosen or has a habitation for himself, for he desires to dwell not in temples of stone, but in the hearts of men. Like us, the Mother of God was subject to death and the condemnation of our first parents. But nevertheless, she was chosen by God before all ages to be the new Eve, the mother of Christ the Savior. And in this, she becomes the source of our redemption and the model for all Christian holiness. God himself had chosen her for her humility, for her obedience, and for her purity. And she it is to whom we turn to find rest in our own hearts, to find protection from all the evils and temptations that surround us. How can we gain this peace and this joy in our own hearts when our own lives are filled with temptations and struggles? Let us strive to be as that other Mary in today's gospel reading, who sat at the feet of the Lord and heard his word. So often in the face of the cares and temptations of life, we react like Martha, becoming annoyed with our brothers and sisters, justifying our own righteousness. righteousness and becoming angry with God himself. But the saints of the church remind us that our battle is not against our brother and our neighbor or their faults and shortcomings. And our battle is certainly not against the God by whose grace we live and move beyond our very existence. Our battle is against the powers and principalities of darkness, against death and corruption, against impurity and evil thoughts. Our battle is against all those things by which man has prevented himself from attaining and returning to the glory of paradise and the glory of salvation. Once again, the Mother of God is our example. If we would humble ourselves in all things and turn to God, if we would try to still the passions in our heart and sit at the feet of Christ, if we would drop all our weapons of anger, of jealousy, and of pride, then we could find that rest, and our hearts would taste of the rest.